Listen, is that a review I hear?
Yeah, it's not going to be Call of Duty. Is that clear? Drew a camera. Wait a smoke.
Admin, wait a beer.
Reviewing games is what we do.
Especially the game with a giant sink poop.
An energy that tastes so sweet.
And a big-ass beer.
Make me complete.
Smoking meth.
Beermaster Rob.
Making reviews is our game.
But with lame-ass jokes.
Oh boy.
Generation Crew.
So, where are we?
Well, take a look behind you.
The Bonami Video Game Museum.
Let's go inside.
Boy, there are a lot of different games around here.
Nowadays, it's Xbox, PC, or PlayStation. Back then, you had hundreds of different consoles, all with just one game. Yep, Pong. Pong was developed and published by Atari Inc. and was the first successful home video game system produced. In order to talk about the home Pong system, marked as Pong, we must first start with the Pong Arcade. Pong was released in the arcades in 1972 and is one of the earliest arcade video games released. Computer Space came out in 1971. The game Pong is a simple two-dimensional sports game that simulates table tennis. There are two paddles and a ball along with a scoreboard. Nolan Bushnell has founded Atari Inc. after designing the arcade's game called Computer Space with Ted Debney. Bushnell felt that he could form his own company to produce and license more video games to other companies because of what he learned working on Computer Space. Computer Space wasn't a success with only 1500 machines sold. But Bushnell felt he had learned a lot in designing the game. He quickly hired Alan Alcorn to join Atari Inc. because of Alcorn's experience with both computer science and electronical engineering, and because both Bushnell and Debney had experience working with Alcorn at Ampex. It should be noticed that Alcorn had no previous experience working on video games, prior to working with Atari Inc.
Pong is heavily influenced by Magnavox Odysseys, tennis games released in 1972. Bushnell today claims that Pong was inspired by previous versions of the electronic tennis that he had seen in the 1960s. However, Alcorn claims that Pong was a direct response to Nolan's viewing of the Magnavox Odyssey's tennis game. Either way, Magnavox went on to sue Atari Inc., Bally, and Coleco and other companies for ripping off versions of the Odyssey's tennis game. Atari Inc. would eventually settle with Magnavox out of court, and Atari would have to pay royalties on the sales of the Pong system. Bushnell felt that they could win the case, however, the legal cost would have been $1.5 million for Atari, which have been exceeded Atari's funds. Bushnell felt that Odyssey's tennis game lacked quality, so he assigned Alcorn on a special project to create a better version of the game. Alcorn improved the tennis game in a number of ways. First, he broke the pedals into 8 different segments to change the ball angle when returned. For example, if the ball hit the pedal on the middle segment, it would return at 90 degrees angle. But the outer segments would return the ball in smaller angles. In addition, Alcorn gradually sped up the ball after each return, resetting when the ball is missed. Dabney wanted Alcorn to program actually sound effects in the game, including hisses and boos from the crowd. Alcorn, however, has limited space available for the programming and was unaware of how to create such sound and using digital circuits. He did eventually figure out how to create different tones, which led to sound effects in the games today. In 1972, Alcorn and Bushnell replaced the prototype of Pong at Annie Cap's Tavern, which was a local bar in the area. They decided to place it near the jukebox at the bar, and it quickly gained popularity. Because of the success and positive feedback out of the public, Bushnell decided to take a trip to Chicago to talk to Bally Midway Manufacturing about financing Pong's distribution. It wasn't before long, though, that Bushnell discovered that he could make more money just keeping it on Atari, rather than getting Bally Midway involved. By this time, however, Bally Midway's interest in Pong had grown, eventually with some of the clever deception. Bushnell convinced Bally Midway to change their mind and back out. This created a problem for Atari Inc., because they had some difficulty getting the financial backing for Pong at the first. Most investors at the time considered Pong a form of pinball, and during this time, pinball was closely associated with the mafia. Atari Inc. eventually received a line of credit through Wells Fargo, and production of the Pong began later that year. By 1973, Pong was shipped to other countries. Due to the success of Pong in the arcades, Harold Lee, an engineer for Atari Inc., proposed to Bushnell to develop a home version of Pong in 1974. Lee and Alcorn would work together to develop a cost-effective home version of Pong. This home Pong prototype would consist of 100 different wires, which were be quickly replaced by one single chip. At the time, the Pong chip was the highest performing chip used for any consumer product. The Pong home system was complete, but Atari Inc. had difficulty marketing the system to retailers. Retailers felt that the system was too expensive. Atari would quickly team up with Sears to help distribute the Pong, and Sears would brand the system as Pong Telegames. The initial order was for 150,000 systems made before the holiday season in 1975, and all systems were sold that season. Atari would later release another version of Pong under its own brand in 1976.
It's so fucking many!
All with a little variety to make each one a little bit more fun than the other. Home consoles and handhelds. The museum wasn't much to look at, but damn, they had a lot of different consoles and so many handhelds. They had so many, we played for hours, and yet we couldn't do them all.
Amazing. Just amazing. Look at them all. It's your room, but 3 stories bigger.
This is only the second level of the building.
From Atari 2600 till the Jaguar. From the NES till the Wii U. Game Boy till 3DS. They had them all. Even the Korean versions. Even the Vectrex. You know, your life isn't complete without a Vectrex. Ooh, look, the Commodore.
Hold on, back up a minute. You say Korean?
Yeah, Japan and Korea had a feud, would lead to a ban for all in and export, but that didn't stop those sneaky bastards. But it wasn't such a success like the actual Nintendo. Now we enter the timeline room. We didn't film in the right order of release because some consoles were in the next room and it was just way too much. We're going to tell something about the history of home consoles, starting from the second generation. Rob, take it away.
The Atari 2600 became the most popular game console of the second generation. Fairchild released the Fairchild Video Entertainment System in 1976, while there had been previous game consoles that used cartridges. Either the cartridges had no information and served the same function as flipping switches on the Odyssey, or the console itself was empty, Coleco Telstar, and the cartridge contained all of the game components. The FAS to store microprocessors instructions. RCA and Atari soon released their own cartridge-based consoles, the RCA Studio 2 and the Atari 2600, originally branded as the Atari Video Computer System. The video game crash of 1977. In 1977, manufacturers of older, obsolete consoles and Pong clones sold their system at last to clear stock, creating a glut in the market and causing the RSA to later Fairchild to abandon their game consoles. Only Atari and Magnavox remained in the home console market, despite suffering losses in 1977 and 1978. In North America, this drove most smaller game companies out of business, but in Europe it had different impact. The reduction in demand for the chip that powered first generation consoles caused the price of those chips to drop dramatically. European manufacturers such as Hanimax, Seikam and Soundic released cartridge-based game consoles that contained no CPU cartridges. For those consoles would contain the same chip that had powered later Pong consoles. Rebirth of the home console market. Initially, the FAS continued to be sold at profit after the 1977 crash, and both Bally with their home library computer in 1977 and Magnavox with the Odyssey 2 in 1978 brought their own programmable cartridge-based console to the market. However, it was not until Atari released a conversion of the arcade hit Space Invaders in 1980 for the Atari 2600 that the home console industry was completely refined. Many consumers bought an Atari console so they could play Space Invaders at home. Space Invaders' unprecedented success started the trend of console manufacturers trying to get exclusive rights to the arcade titles, and the trend of advertisement for game consoles claiming to bring the arcade experience home. Throughout the early 1980s, other companies released video game consoles of their own. Many of the video game systems were technically superior to the Atari 2600 and marketed as improvement over the Atari 2600. However, Atari dominated the console market in the early 1980s. Video game crash of 1983. In 1983, the video game business suffered a much more severe crash. A flood of consoles, low-quality video games by smaller companies, especially from the 2600 industry, leader Atari hyping games such as E.T. Oh God! And a 2600 Pac-Man that were poorly received, and a growing number of home computer users caused the consumers and retailers to lose faith in the video game console. most video game companies filed for bankruptcy or moved into other industries, abandoning their game consoles. A group of employees from Mattel Electronics formed the INTV Corporation and bought the rights for the Intellivision. INTV alone continued to manufacture the Intellivision in small quantities and released new Intellivision games until 1991. All other North American game consoles were discontinued by 1984. Now, Matthew, the third generation, take it away.
Alright, the third generation. The NES made video games popular again after 1983 crash. In 1983, Nintendo released a Family Computer, or Famicom, in Japan. The Famicom supported high-resolution sprites, larger color palettes, and titled backgrounds. This allowed Famicom games to be longer and have more detailed graphics. Nintendo began attempts to bring their Famicom to the US after the video game market had crashed. In the US, video games were seen as a fad that had already passed. To distinguish its product from older game consoles, Nintendo released their Famicom as the Nintendo Entertainment System, the NES, which used a front-loading cartridge port similar to a VCR, included a plastic robot, Rob, and was intently advertised as a toy. The NES was the highest selling console in the history of North America and realized the video game market. Mario of Super Mario Bros. Became a global icon starting with his NES games. Nintendo took an unusual stance with third-party developers for its console. Nintendo constructively restricted third-party developers to 3 NES titles per year and forbade them from developing for other video game consoles. The practice ensured Nintendo's market dominance and prevented the flood of crash titles that had helped kill Atari, but was ruled illegal late in the console's lifecycle. Sega's Master System was intended to compete with the NES, but never gained any significant market share in the US or Japan, and was barely profitable. It fared notably better in PAL territories. In Europe and South America, the Master System competed with the NES and saw new games released, even after Sega's next generation, Mega Drive, was released. In Brazil, where strict importance laws and rampant privacy kept our competitors, the Master System outsold the NES by a massive margin and remained popular in the 90s. Jack Tramiel, after buying Atari, downsized its staff and, settling its legal disputes, attempted to bring back Atari into the home console market. Atari released a smaller, sleeker, cheaper version of their popular Atari 2600. They also released the Atari 7800, a console technically compared with the NES and backwards compatible with the 2600. Finally, Atari repackaged its 8-bit XA home computers as the XAGS game console. The new consoles helped Atari claw its way out of debt, but failed to gain much market share from Nintendo. Atari's lack of funds meant that its consoles saw fewer releases, lower production values, both the manual and the game labels were frequently black and white, and limited distribution. The most popular consoles of the third generation were the Famicom, NES, the Sega Master System, the Atari 7800, and the Atari XAGS.